with strengths in each department, the lane, the mid game with team fight. They have decent Roshan as well with the PA. So Mineski for me.
Okay.
I think they've got over-glaring team fight on Mineski. I do really like what they've got going. And Ame playing Ursa, we saw maybe playing it, but Ame playing it, I like him more when he's just playing these hard carry type heroes, and that's not one of them.
10 seconds remaining.
So Mineski for you. Mm-hmm. Okay, both of our experts have taken Mineski to win the opening game in this best of three grand final. Are they going to be correct? We'll find out, of course, at the end of this one. Who takes the advantage early on? Let's find out as we head over to our commentary team for the opening of the grand final. Some magic and some Star Wars with Merlini and Toby One.
That makes you the magic.
Woo! I do like playing any heroes, if that counts.
I believe that. I believe that woo. That woo.
Yeah, it wasn't fake.
It wasn't. It was only missing the W at the end to be a real LD wow. We are going to go into this game. It is familiar territory for Mineski. I don't know if it's familiar territory to have the panel actually go full one-sided with Mineski. Do you believe in the boys as well?
I like their lineup more. However, Rushi PA... I have a question mark about that. I saw his PL. I was not happy with his PL. PA, I haven't seen him play too much. There's some heroes he just plays amazingly. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm all in on Mushi this game. Like, his Ventral Spirit is really, really good. Is Phantom Assassin, I don't think I'm going to be impressed by it.
How? Okay. Where can you go wrong with Phantom Assassin?
Builds are hard with PA. Because you have to build BKB at some point generally, but PA also really struggles a lot versus Silencer. It's not often that you see that matchup here, because Phantom Assassin is one of those heroes that actually needs to cast tons of spells, where spells are 6 and 5 seconds, respectively, on her first two spells. So that means Curse of the Silent is going to just
wreck.
It's going to destroy you. And you don't have a good way to get it off, right? You have to deal with Global already, so, like, what are you going to get? BKB, Manta? Like, those are not really great. But, you know, you can just go to Phase Dezo. I do like the matchup versus the Enchantress, though. High attack speed is great versus the Ench, and also she's a low armor hero versus the pure physical. It's very good.
Yeah. So, lane matchup works when LGD, as Winter and Fog were saying, like, at the end of the draft, they were trying to balance their lanes up to give themselves an advantage. And with our lanes actually unfolding now, it looks like at least Mineski will get that matchup of PA versus the Enchantress up on the top, unless... No, okay, he just was there for the rune. It is still going to be ice on the offlane. They've gone for practically the same build with the PMS. Only difference is the shared tangos and LGD are going to make life difficult for Mushi.
Yep.
Two heroes already moving into position. There's no vision from the Radiant in this area as well. So Yao's moving in, he's got boots as well as the Burrow Strike ready. Chicken reveals itself for half a second, but they want Mushi just to come a little bit further out. So Flame Gun starts doing his damage, but Mushi's too close to the tower. It looks like Yao, as well as QQQ, doesn't believe that's on.
That was a good block coming up from maybe. That's one of the problems with having supports over here, is that they won't actually be in a position to get a good block for the lane.
It's harassment, nothing more, with the Burrow Strike.
Just a little bit, same King's not. Harassing like that, you need a little bit more room to chase generally, but Silencer are getting a lot of work done on bottom lane.
Yeah, Arcane Curse made a lot easier when both Moon and Ninja Boogie stand next to each other.
Yep, and they did get the Enchantress versus the Monkey King matchup that they did not, so Ursa in offlane, not very common, but still it's gonna be fine for FY.
Yeah, I've just messed up his timing. He came down a fraction of a second too early. He was looking for the Courier Snipe. And he aggroed the range creep. So it didn't really work for him on that front. But
it's still really
it was
hard to get a courier kill as a melee. You generally have to smoke for it this early in the game.
Yeah. So far, he hasn't wanted to commit that heavily into it. Because we did see the movement from Mineski up on top. Monkey King does not want to let FY have space. There's a nice little Phantom Strike away from Mushi. Is okay.
Jabs,
I don't think he got the memo that they were not investing into this mid lane with a gank. Somnus, Slide of Fist Searing Chains, an early point in that slide. He was able to close the distance, but not enough.
Very well played by maybe still.
I'm just getting started.
Okay, he's still dying. He is not level 3 yet. I think you really need that level 3 untouchable or level 2 untouchable before you can really stand on land for Monkey. But yeah, ice is Monkey King. Very scary.
Nice arrow from Moon. Already set it up with the Frost Blast. It's enough slow that it was
even with CS and not die to the heavy rotations. The amount of times Yao's actually committed to this mid lane, like, you haven't seen him take any of the bounty runes, and he's sitting still shy of level 2, leeching experience from Somnus.
He could kill the Monkey King. I think Monkey King's a fairly easy kill for them. He's very low on regen right now after that first
invisibility.
I think they're just trying to pressure the other cores, more importantly, the ones that need more farm.
And this vision of Mineski, like, yeah, and they've been fantastic with this throughout the entire tournament. But that one observer was watched most of the rotations down the bot lane, so it saw the fact that Silencer was moving it. It didn't, however, see the invis rune of Yao's Ninja Pookie in close, puts on the Frost Blast, rolling Boulder forward. They're creating space, allowing Morana to leap herself further away, and they're focusing on QQQ. Moon, not a lot of life, and that Arcane Curse is still problematic. He'll need to regenerate back up again, but invis gank from LGD, not paying off.
This is also a tough Ursa game, too. Like, Ursa is going to need Defusal. It's a hard life for melee heroes, given with the Frost Armor. Ember, not really in that same vein, because he doesn't really just play right click that much.
It's always funny watching, like, Monkey King, who wants to get to the 4th hit, but up against 2 points up in Untouchable, makes it very difficult bottom lane. Arme, in real issues, leap forward, star fall, that bonus damage will be enough. And QQQ already did everything he possibly could.
They are getting destroyed. It's not looking so good for them.
So how do you recover? Like, the Sandcast now moving around, at least able to secure the DD rune for Somnus's bottle. He took a bounty rune, but, like, the Silencer is forced off the bottom lane.
We haven't actually seen Lich too much this tournament, and there's kind of varying philosophies on how to deal with Lich. Some players swear that you should just, if Lich is safe lane, you just don't go to that lane. Like, you either overcommit to the lane so you can actually kill him, or you just commit nobody because you're not getting any experience from all the denied range creeps. So that's one way that people view dealing with Lich, but it looks like they're actually just sitting in the lane, so they're still going to get a lot of their XP ruined in that bottom lane as a result. So I think they do need to get maybe one or two kills on the Lich, because he is still kind of just making absolutely for Ursa. Luckily for Ursa, he can catch up to Roche, but, you know, you're not really looking at Roche right now, you're looking at more in the 10-15 minute range.
Yeah. Well, suppose, like, with the build you're getting in from the Enchantress, you can go in there and tank Roshan while Ursa kills it off. But at this rate, okay, mid lane Mushi, able to blink away. Somnus, you're in pretty deep at the moment. He is level 6, however, Stifling Dagger slowing him up. Yao's the neighborhood, maybe need to create a little bit of space for the Fire Strike. Jab's already in there with the kick. Somnus just walking it off like a stitch.
He won the gun. He has 10 stick charges in his inventory, so he was not really in danger.
It's just the lack of defensive spirit and a potential crit from Mushi. Because he cracked level 6 while that was all going on. Always get a little bit cautious about things.
Yeah, he doesn't have a blight though, so it's not as bad as it would seem. Wonder if he is going to get a blight. I've seen a lot of PAs go without blight, and it's just like, why? Blight is just so good for that hero. And it actually helps you get towers too, which is a pretty big weakness for PA.
PA just found himself a haste rune. QQQ is going to come out looking for it. He is not in. Actually, he was for a second in range of Radiant Vision, thanks to the Observer Ward. But Jabs is wrapping around the back. Aggressive ward on the bottom lane behind the tier 1 tower.
I wonder if any of the cores are going to build Silver Edge 2 on LGD to deal with the PA blur. Because the Ursa and the Monkey, you don't really want two heroes to build MKB. It's kind of a big waste, especially when it's doubtful that Monkey King's gonna have any evasion. He doesn't go, they usually go for an attack speed talent at level 10.
Well, it seems like the Ursa is the only one where it makes sense to build a Silver Edge, but even then he wants a Blink Dagger.
No, I think
Not Somnus in trouble, but jump away. Escapes. ISIS's initiation, thanks to the defensive spirit, and now we'll burn the shrine. Meanwhile, FY is making the most out of ISIS not being there. Enchants the Radiant Siege Creep. Looks to add pressure to that top tier 1.
He finally has phase, so Monkey King did get that one-on-one kill, so he was a phase up.
They're gonna gank. Somnus is, he's got three spirits ready to commit. All they're gonna do is just hold Monkey King in position. And Impetus damage is almost enough to do it. It'll be Somnus who gets it with that Slider Fist. So, nice rotations in from LGD. Critical one force. They'll lose QQQ in the meantime. In mid lane, quick silence onto the SK, and he cannot get himself out just yet. The silence lasts a little bit longer, so we got the Fire Strike.
Yoshi, but he knew he wasn't going to outrun a haste-ruined Phantom Assassin.
Yeah, tough break for LGD there. Losing two supports though, and getting the Monkey King in the tower, that is pretty good. Nice use of the range creep by F1. They have terrible tower hitters, so I'm actually very surprised that they got the tower this early. I was looking at their lineup, I was like, oh my god, Ember and Ursa, how are they ever going to right-click towers unless they just win a team fight?
Enchantress stolen army to double catapult. That's what you.
Yeah. That's what you. Her with a lance, I guess, is like not the Radiant's worst. Radiant's top tower in the world, is under attack. But still pretty bad.
This should make my life easier.
So no blight. The blightless build.
You were already saying like how like you're uncertain about the builds on PA. Yeah. That's what makes the hero.
Mushi's kind of hit or miss. I remember watching his Ember at Starladder one season. I was just like, oh my god, he does not play Ember Spirit ever.
you were mentioning your level of tilt before. Nice little dodge from Yao. Moon's not gonna hit that one.
I think Black also went a blightless Phantom Assassin too, but it's very very rare. I think. Sometimes you might do it if you're going for like a magic oriented build with very high armor heroes, I think TB in particular, but even then it's like it's still dubious.
There's a smoke movement coming in from Mineski. Mushi he stuck around a little bit longer just so he could pick up the phase boost, but now it's both Mushi and Jabs teaming up. Meanwhile in the bottom lane, Yao, nice bar of strike, spirit committal. Moon will end up falling and the rebuttal is coming from Mineski. So, what is their target? There's two to go for, and they definitely want to grab FY. A quick slap, jump in, and the following jump, and even a kick from Jabs, following up into the silence. They will be able to catch up to him. He's got one quick last word, and this scores proper for Jabs. He's already starting his TP out. The damage from the range creep, it's not enough to kill him. He'll live with the regeneration of the fountain, and Mineski, even though they do lose that safe laner, they end up taking two up on top. But once again, LGD is pressuring buildings.
Enchantress is very, very poor versus this massive physical burst too. So you can see the inherently bad matchup that the Enchantress has, just no time to heal up at all. Might have to itemize more for HP as opposed to damage. Like you might need to build like a lance super early on for that extra strength.
Yeah, much of a problem doing that, like Lance Hurricane Pike to push. Obviously the PA can just Phantom Strike back in again.
Oh, it's
like
great
to get Monkey King out of his ulti too.
Potentially, yeah. I think Pike's pretty much a no-brainer on Enchantress. But the Blight on PA would also help out the Monkey King a lot too, who's also very high physical. Okay, I see him building a desert. I can breathe a sigh of relief.
Phase Boots, Aquila, PMS first. Basic items, then we can look into the extra stuff. Even though Blightstone is obviously instinctively cheap. Ninja Boogie's in a bad spot. Yao gonna come in for the Burrow Strike, in from behind, but it's more of a setup here for Ame, who can rip apart that Lich. He lets the Chain Frost go, but it's kind of just like, at the end of it. Little bit of damage, hold the creep wave back. LGD maybe a little bit lucky it didn't bounce unfavorably towards them.
So now is about the time you can start thinking about Roche. It's almost nighttime. Pretty good time to do it because they don't have great ways of scouting. I would say maybe Monkey King can scout around the pit, maybe an arrow, but still, whenever you reverse Ursa, the window is very, very small to try and contest Roche. And he is also going for a Mask of Madness, so that also cuts down on the window a little bit more. So if Monkey King like shows on bottom lane, for example, that would be a perfect time for them to maybe even TP to the shrine and do it. So Isis has to be very careful about where he moves and make sure that he does stick around that area so that he can scout out Roche just in case.
Well, he is actually headed down to bottom lane. Like, he's in the jungle for the moment, but in a couple of seconds he'll reveal on bot.
They do have good wards though around Roche, and they know that Ursa isn't going to go for the finger first because he does have the mask. So I think they're like still...
They're iffy about it.
Yeah,
Moon's scouting. He's probably the only one that can escape with 12-1 charges and that level 2 leap.
They'd have to smoke for 2, though.
Do you think it's like LGD can still do it? Like, you talk about Monkey King revealing himself on bottom. Having Enchantress also revealing herself on bottom, doesn't that take away a large portion of the easy power that LGD has to do Roshan?
Nah, it's by himself. Ursa's just... the best solo Roche hero, hands down, no question about it, especially if he has lifesteal. Like, sometimes you can do it without lifesteal, if you have a... if you're just really farmed, or if you have a DD room. But with a mask, it should be sweet. If
Mineski is really uncertain about what's going on at the moment, but with the Moonlight Shadow, there's an Invis rune on the Earth Spirit. I'm looking for detection.
right now on LGD, and it just doesn't exist. The arrow will fly astray. Moon unable to connect onto Somnus, and because this is nighttime, division range is quite poor. Mineski cannot find their target. And LGD, they're already moving up. Face moves from Arfme. He's not going into Roshan, however. Angle up.
They still have to worry about it, though. Look at the other two heroes that are, like, you have to just constantly consider it. Especially when there's, like, a feint maneuver and nothing actually happens in the bottom lane. And you'll see them just hanging around, seeing what's going on. Where are you?
Ursa goes missing from the map. Their observer ward is too shallow on the dire side of the jungle.
Yeah.
That's the reason why Mineski just don't understand what's going on at the moment.
That's the first obvious time for them to do Roche too, so you don't...
Moon, get out of that leap! If it wasn't for that high ground observer ward, he would be dead right now. Sleight of Fist Searing Chains would have grabbed him.
Yeah, he did completely reveal the ward.
He did.
Save his life.
The ward's only got a minute and a half left on it, so they may not be too sad about that.
They might make a move. His shield is almost down.
They see him. Oh, actually, do they? The observer ward's a little bit too far off, so instead, they go top rolling boulder into kick silence, and Yao, in a world of hurt, Moon combining up with the heavy damage of Mushi and Jets.
Oh, that hurts. He was at like 1800, 1900 gold before that.
Ice is waiting on bottom. He's really keeping this bottom lane pushed in, so the tier 1 tower is kind of always under threat. But 14 minutes in, Ursa has had the Mask of Banners for a while. And it's like he's waiting until he completes his Blink Dagger before he goes near Roshan.
Well, it's one of those games where they're like not in a firm position of power. So if they actually do take a fight around the Roche pit, which old Earth Spirit would destroy them. So they have to be a little bit careful. And it's also one of those games where if you don't get Roche, you're probably going to be useless for the majority of the game as Ursa. So he does have to approach it with care.
So you have to get Roshan, but don't feed your life. Like what's happening to Ninja Boogie underneath the tier 1 tower.
You just wait for
this with the DD.
You just wait for a good opportunity. You don't want like a 50-50 chance of getting Roche for free.
Radiance,
yeah. There's gonna be a point at some time. You just have to be patient.
That good opportunity seems really hard though. Like LGD keep having to react to this with pushing that's coming in from an SK.
Well, once it gets Blink, it's also better too, because then he doesn't have to expend a smoke to do it. So that's also something else.
That's if they have vision, like you still have to come around the top. If you do that, then you're gonna come in range of the... Actually, the Radiant Observer was now timing out. But there'll be a new ward pretty soon by Mineski placed down. Who's actually got him? It's in the hands of the Lich at the moment. So I'm interested to see where Ninja Boogie's going to be placing that. Our next attention should be up towards the top. Rolling boulder silence once again, but Chats finds himself in way too deep. Turns on the magnetizer. The creep wave will soak up the arrow from Moon. I was going to try and create a little bit of space. The Moonlight Shadow being triggered, but with the sentry ward down from LGD, they had perfect vision.
They can also take a big team fight pretty soon. They almost have the Blink Dagger on Yao, and then they can use Yao to Burrow Strike and Epicenter into a fight with a Global Silence. That should be an easy win fight. There's no way they can deal with Global Silence this far if they have the Burrow Strike for the ball at least. No BKBs, no main spells, no really cool.
Man, Boogie,
that's a fast desert from Lucian. He's
getting. You get all the space up on top. Like LGD's adding pressure towards bottom, they're trying to fight and be around Roshan, then Ursa went into the jungle, and Mushi just went top lane.
Yeah.
Disappeared for a good 5 minutes and then farmed up the entire thing.
And now they have pretty good Roche potential too. The TA and then the Frost Armor.
Mm-hmm.
It's all pretty good. Having a lot of trouble pushing out the lanes right now, though, on the side of LGD.
Yeah.
But with BOTs up on, maybe it should be much easier now.
It's amazing how many levels and farm Ice has managed to achieve on this bottom lane, because he hasn't left it. You talked about Monkey King revealing himself on the bottom lane being a bad thing, but the level of pressure he's had down here without having to move off. Oh, that crit! Woo! All right.
Yep.
That's an observer's challenge right there. When a hero with one attack can go from 100% to 10%.
He's going the same item build as he did in other Enchantress game, but this is a completely different game where he went phase drums into Pyke into Orchid, but like that's no armor and very little HP. Like
LGD, it's the Blink Dagger epicenter from Yao, jumping himself forward. Nice burst reveal. Lich Chain Frost gonna be bouncing around between Arme as well as Yao until Yao hides in the invisible sandstorm.
He might even consider buying a Ghost Scepter. I mean, he's already so far into the four staff that it's kind of hard not to.
Got to commit to what he's got.
Yeah.
Mirana just picked up a Diffuser Blade as well. well, so I don't know if the ghost is really going to help him that much. Battle on bottom lane, rolling boulder forward, but defensive spirits there. So Ember Spirit able to get back out again from the initiation on bottom.
Tiny bit late on the silence.
Where is Ame off to? I think he's trying to find Jab. Starts his TP underneath the shrine. Jabs will see him at the last moment. And pinging out the fact that he's moving, but he's right up the creep web anyway, so Mineski know all. There's your 4-star on FY. So it doesn't have the health, but at least has the maneuverability that comes with it.
Yeah, it's tough, because, like, realistically in a fight, you're going to get daggered, and then you're going to get blink strike, you're going to get hit once, and then he has a 4-star. So if, like, one of those is crit, God forbid if both are crit. He's still gonna have a lot of moves. And Monkey King Balance Strike, that thing will destroy him, especially with the Desert debuff on him. So I am very worried for FY's life.
He'll try and live. If he had a little bit more money to his name, maybe we'd have some more confidence. Like, you look at Mushi there at the moment, sitting at the top net worth on the board, but you'll have to go halfway down and a bit further to catch up to FY's net worth.
Yeah, he's just gonna have to play it safe and just sit in the back and rely a lot more on the Ursa and the Ember to create havoc.
Mm-hmm. Well, right now the Ursa doesn't have that ticket to create havoc. He needs the Aegis the Immortal up his sleeve. And how long do you want to wait? He's got Blink Dagger, he's got Mask of Madness building into the BKB now as well. This is all taking time. Ember Spirit went for the magical kind of aggression. He could have gone with that Veil of Discord. And
he needs armor badly. Like, yeah. Armor is very important to this game. Like, even to the point where Ursa might consider building a Vlad for his team instead of the Mask of Madness. The Mask of Madness helps him farm a lot faster, but Radiant, it's just something else to consider when you really want armor for your team. No one else is really going to buy a Vlad except for him.
Well, both teams scanning out. Mineski's checking Roshan, and LGD is checking behind. Actually, was that the other way around? Need to color those scans. Either way, scan around Roshan, scan around the mid-tier 1 tower of Radiant. Both don't flag anything. LGD are very defensive up on that top lane. It's like they're waiting for somebody to come up and farm it.
Pierre was around that area, but Mushi's been playing it safe. Mushi's been playing very well this game.
And he's actually backed up towards his own Ancients. Always dodging the movement of LGD. Okay, I still haven't seen Ice move off this bottom lane. Not in the last 10 minutes. He's almost got Diffusal Blade.
Yeah, so much for Ghost Scepter.
Yeah, there's two Diffusal Blades up. One on Morana, one on the Monkey King shortly.
And so much for Ember's Yules too, that might be tough for him.
Ame's farming up near the Ancients, so Mineski can have that early warning. We asked where the ward was going to go from Ninja Boogie, and he got it in really nice and deep. And you see LGD trying to counter ward around Roshan. They put down the sentry near the top rune. But thanks to that observe ward, they saw the blink in. They understand that Ame is now doing Roshan. How will Mineski react?
Well, they'd have to be able to buy back if they wanted to defend this, but it's not really happening.
Yeah, Mushi dying is not the way you want this to go down.
That's the thing, they were so patient.
Got the arrow. Arrow will fly forward, and, well, it'll hit the Ursa, but already LGD have the Aegis Immortal in their hands. Okay, they're gonna go in. You've got the Wukong's Command out. Yao get the Virus Strike on, but with Wukong's Command, it's difficult for Ame to get back out. He'll end up having the Aegis Immortal triggered, and four heroes surrounding him. The buyback from Mushi still doesn't come, but the arrow from Moon hitting right on the money. Ame kicked out. He will go down twice. Enchantress ends up buying back. So you get Roshan, but you lose the Ursa twice. You end up burning money on an Enchantress who was already pissed poor. That is not exactly how LGD thought that was going to happen.
That was very poorly played by LGD. They saw I don't think they expected him to jump, but with the arrow, they actually caught glimpse of the tail end of the Enrage. They're like, okay, well, Ursa doesn't have Enrage. We can arrow him immediately after Aegis. Why not? Let's do it. But they should have just 4-staff him out right here. I think if you just push him out, the fight is okay. He's outside the cage. He's not locked in. He can blink out. He's almost out of monkey control, but it was just way too sloppy. That's why maybe playing a little bit too simple. These games.
And now they lose Yao as well. Like, after all of that, that's problematic to say the least for LGD. They'll need a good opening, Somnus. Well, if he had a little bit more mana, he has the one charges available, so he just roots up Moon, but we'll see how much battle they've got when Ame comes in. And that definitely took Moon by surprise. That quick burst dash.
more fun than this.
Echo Saber and Diffuser Blade. Having a little bit of trouble. Starts his TP out. There is no stun available, however. Yao's TP takes too long.
And BKB now. PA.
She has the entire thing. BKB deaths are
pretty much no chance of her dying to BKB. There's usually like impetus and power, overpower Ursa. I'm gonna take it out. Not doing it for her. No. She's gonna be ridiculously strong in these next team fights. So I think LGD just have to just sit back and not really do that much for a while.
That doesn't seem like a wonderful plan when PA continues to grow with levels of money.
Yeah, it's
late game, Mineski's lineup looks very, very scary. Maybe not so much right now.
It's very scary, but you have Diffuser on Monkey King, you have BKB on PA, so these two are just going to destroy the fight. And yep. LGD, they have to catch someone off guard, but even with maybe they can catch Mushi out with a stun and use a lot of magic grips at the start of the fight, but even that's very, very risky. And I think that Global Silence is losing a lot of value right now because of how slow the game is and how quickly Mineski are getting their PKBs.
Gold and sweet.
Mineski are just really fast with the fight too. They cast all their spells before the Global came out during the Rouge bit, so Global Silence and same thing ultimately.
Kind of difficult as well for LGD to respond. She said they die so quickly, and what happens if that kiting does happen? Wukong's command comes in, you don't want to walk into it anyway. Top tier two towers now going to fall, and LGD is still wondering exactly how they play this. Ice is swinging from trees up on top, hoping someone from LGD will come out of the base, but no one's there from LGD. The new creep wave's on the way in with that jump forward. He doesn't see all the way up yet, but LGD did just see Ice jump inside the base, but TPs are coming to bottom lane. Somnus is on the tower, and LGD are ready for this fight. Yao's perfectly behind the tree, side of Fisterian Chain's gonna find Mushi. Remember, he has the BKB. He is ready to fight. And the only thing defending the top lane for LGD currently is an Enchantress creep. So they're bringing more friends in.
It's warding by Mineski too.
They just saw the Ursa.
He has BKB, so he's feeling okay.
Yeah. It's just seeing him and then being able to move away, like Moon was farming, is like, okay, well, this isn't the play. So they just changed their lanes up. There's only two remaining tier 2 towers. You could just split the lanes out a little bit more. Bottom lane, Epicenter, Mushi has to be controlled, gets the BKB off. Yao, Burrow strikes up, but Mushi! Man, that's smaller. Yeah. Monkey King. That's the Wukong command go. Man, Ame's dying to this. BKB burn from him limps away. He is really expecting Ice to hit like that.
Yeah, that was so ambitious. He's not level 12. There's not the Veil debuff on him. He, I believe, Phantom Assassin also went for the HP talent. Yeah. So that's. Nice play.
One way to push him down. Up in the tree, taking a lot of damage. Quick slap, searing chains. Arrow will fly forward. Connects on FY. One more attack from Ice will get it. Not certain if it really works, but the fire strike from Yao is able to connect onto Moon. And both Ame and Somnus will catch up to him quickly. The trade off is the tier 2 tower on the bottom lane that Mushi is currently taking.
Smoke got detected.
Oh, they're actually coming right back. Jabs is just playing King of the Hill. He's got Blink Dagger, so he can easily jump back down. Well, okay, maybe not so easily now. Rolling Boulder, he's silenced up. The tier 2 tower's already gone. And Jabs, okay, stick on the hill. And that's what that was. And Ninja Boogie will die as well. Mineski are actually managed to somehow lose 4 heroes across almost every part of this map.
That's good. That's good. All the ways to. I guess it's the only way to really break a tree. I don't see the Quelling Blades out anymore, so.
Just gonna be that full stomp through.
Yeah, casual slip and slide.
I actually only have that one. You're right, that there's nothing else, and there's no other full stomps. Silence, and maybe he would love to afford that, but.
Ember could too with a Remnant. He tried it earlier, but yeah, that'd be it's very improbable. You have to know exactly where he is. or kind of guess.
Mushi's gonna be finding a friend pretty soon. Somnus, just in the neighborhood. BKB is now done for Ice. So the big melee cause of Mineski now having that magic immunity.
BKB is a big problem because they can't do anything versus BKB. Like, if it's BKB wars, Ursa usually wins that fight, but not this game. There's Frost Armor that he's gonna have to deal with, and there's Blur, and then there's Monkey King, also with a ton of armor during his ulti, and additional armor from Frost Armor, and then life dealing with Jingu, and he's against low armor heroes, so he's gonna be hitting you really, really hard. So, like, you don't want a large damage. You're just gonna bring your BKBs, you're gonna run away, and then you're probably gonna lose one or two heroes, and Mineski are probably still gonna win the non BKB.
That's a lot of problems to list on a piece of paper,
man. Just kind of waited out a little bit.
Oh, Mineski missing their target. They were smoked up looking for QQQ, who moved down.
You wait for a really good opportunity with the Sand King. So Yao has a lot on his shoulders this game. It's not going to be the same as the EG series where he can miss for a little bit. He's going to need to have a really good epicenter to start the fight and get a ton of damage on the pole.
That's it, pretty deep. The arrow won't connect. Thanks to the Basher on Army. Freshen up. He has something that can get through that BKB, but now the Wukong Command, Global Silence is out. Wukong Command, Onika, splits this fight up a little bit, ends with Silence of dying, and Mushi having room to escape. The Tier 2 tower has fallen as well. Some heavy commitments, BKBs, both of them burned from Mineski, as well as Ursa. Everyone who had it popped it.
Yep, you're happy with BKB and BKB fights. I think he got really unlucky. Too. Like, he actually clobbered through his BKB. Maybe he didn't have Frost Armor before that fight. I'm not exactly sure what won him, but there's no way that the Phantom Sensor should be even that close in danger of dying, especially with no Epicenter coming out.
Well, you want to play the RNG game, you just have that Mask of Madness as well as Overpower. You're gonna attack so quickly, hit a bash.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not really RNG, it's 50%. 50% is pretty high. You can only get so unlucky with that.
It's good odds, man. It's good odds. Yeah. Am I going red or am I going black? Either way, it's a 50-50 chance. Yao's gonna show himself up on top. It's probably the last thing he wanted to do. The kick is perfect in there from Chaps. So SK on the sidelines, 43 seconds, thought he might have some breathing room while the rest of LGD was hunting mid. They have that Invis rune on the Ursa as Ame. He hasn't found a target yet. Now he'll find Ninjabugi Moon in the neighborhood, but Ninjabugi dead so quickly. They're going to defuse the blade on Ursa, so he's actually out of mana for the moment. Makes it difficult to use those wonderful items of his. And then BKB, he has enough. Rolling bottom forward. This BKB is not going to last much longer. And LGD don't want to come up here and try and help him. If he's not coming closer towards the shrine. So instead, they just let the Ursa die. There is the follow-up into the mid, but the follow-up is Mineski. It's not the other way. LGD continuously losing heroes. Spirit Jump in and out. Mushi's BKB will protect the Somnus. Is able to get that defensive spirit near the Ancients and TP all the way home. But more heroes on the sideline at LGD. The only good thing for them is the fact that Roshan is max spawn time.
Usually that's a bad thing for an Ursa.
They maybe actually checked it before and they couldn't do it.
Maybe still made the most out of that. Almost killing Mushi and at the very least popping his BKB at that point and not dying. Good. I still have to give a lot of credit for that. And yeah, Ame, I think Fog mentioned on the panel, he's usually known for these like harder carries, like the Terrorblade anti-mage. And then like, he just traded his life for a Lich. Normally you just like BKB TP out, but he got a mana burn very, very quickly.
This ward near the Ancients, like we've seen VGJ do it. Almost every single person has done it near the Radiant Ancients.
Yep.
It's like the standard ward almost now for VGJ as well as LGD. But you missed it with the Sentry.
So
Roshan begins.
Yeah, where are you, dude?
Double damage.
Lanes are pushed out. Solstice has BTs. He can come to the shrine. Roshan's down at 50%.
DD.
They're smoked up. Like, if this DD wasn't here, they would have potentially had a chance of arriving in time. Now they jump in, Ame with the BKB and the Searing Chains. They bring down the Earth Spirit, combining with the Epicenter. Moon is low, but Mushi, a 16, almost 1700 crit, ends Ame. And they're looking for more. Yao stunned in the corner. The bounce up here by Monkey King. He'll pounce back down again. Combining up with the rest of the double damage.
on the Phantom Assassin.
Yeah, the DD made all the difference there. It would have been much different fight. Because the epicenter came out, but it was like very expected, very easy to pucker BKB when they're all not inside the pit. And yeah, Mushi just crushed.
Why pick a Phantom Assassin for that exact reason? Somnus in trouble, Diffuser Blade's going to work, Mushi. Phantom Strike falls, Somnus just bouncing around, jumping from shrine to shrine. While Mineski beat at the tier 3 town, fortification will wear off. Another defensive spirit is down for Somnus. Mushi, not a healthy man. Remember, he's got the Aegis Immortal. He's happy to commit if they can get something in return. The Glimmer Cape making it difficult for LGD just to jump on him. As Ice has popped the BKB, Wukong Commander's available. So if LGD want to come out to this, they'll come into it with a double barrel and perfect strike. Ice.
Start getting banned out.
I think he's dead as well. One crit. He's even gonna get bashed up by Mushi. The BKB versus BKB. Who wins this one? They've got the regeneration of the shrine. Now it's worn off. Somnus, silent stuff. Mushi looking for the crit. Yalbara strikes in for Moon. Hits the money with the arrow and LGD. They're almost all dead. Where's that rolling ball? Not gonna happen with the slide of Viserion Chains. The cycling dagger. Crit, slows, and the boundless strike. Now officially they're all dead. You can fight back on the Ember, but they realize resistance is futile. LGD gets slapped down by Mineski in game one.
And the PA countered two of their picks really, really hard. And they played it really well, played it slow. Ice. I really do think Ice probably second phase ban would be appropriate. He was very good at finding farm and just getting so much done around the map and in the team fights.
He ended up finishing that game with 16,000 damage. Not too shabby. There's only one person who was above him. Considering the crits that were happening in those fights, it was Mushi with like an extra 1,000-ish worth of damage over him. It was a wonderful display from both Mushi and Ice. Great teamwork by all of Mineski and LGD. Got to think up something, have a little bit of a break to work it out and come back for game two.